You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at borisfx.com. And welcome back to the final part of exercise 18, where we look at the lens module in Mocha Pro. Now, sometimes we don't have perfect or even suitable material for judging what lens calibration is going to be. So sometimes you might just have big patches of blue sky or just loads of trees, something natural where you don't have lots and lots of straight lines. I mean, we have a few straight lines here, but even so, if you're shooting with the same lenses time and time again, then the best way of getting proper calibrated lenses is using a calibration chart. And it doesn't have to be anything too complex. All after is just something nice and simple that shows off the distortions within the image. So this is the calibration chart that I've shot for this lens. And I can't see exactly what the lens is, but I know it's an 11 to 16 zoom at 11 millimeters. So this is the widest it's going to be. So we do have quite a lot of distortion. All right, let's get on with it. Let's go to our Mocha Pro and bring in our calibration clip. And this is quite a big clip. If I come into the clip properties, you can almost see that it's a 6K file. So 5568 by 3132. If we were working in Mocha Pro standalone, you can drop the proxy down up at the top to be viewing this in a smaller proxy mode. If we're working in the plugin, then the plugin takes on the proxy mode that the host is giving us. But we're working at full res. It's not going to be too bad for this. We've got a decently fast machine, but we don't really need to use proxy for this, I don't think. Let's go into our lens module again, and I'm going to locate lines just as we did previously. Okay, and let's turn up the lines again, just as we did previously, to see if we can cut through some of the shorter lines. Not really. I actually probably want to use most of these. What I'll do then is I'll just shorten it up a little bit so that we've got a nice coverage up at the top. Because that seems to be our weakest point. And I'm going to go new line and let's just start taking some of these lines. And I'm going to come in and I'm going to start working on the top edge. Because these are short lines, I do have to select a fair few bits of it. Here we go. Lovely. And I'll hit N and let's zoom out a little bit and pan around Z and X. What I'll do is I'll just take a section of these. So I'll take where the thick lines are. So I'm going to hit N again and go on the top line of this one as well. Nice and straightforward. N again, go to the next top line, which is going to be around about here. So you see, as these lines get longer, it's actually a bit easier to select them. The lines are probably shorter at the top because, there's much more distortion at the top. Excellent. Hit N again. Let's come down to the next fat line, which is this one here. And final one, top of this one at the bottom. Excellent. Now, once I've done all the horizontal lines, let's do the vertical lines as well. I'm going to take the right side edge, N for a new line. And again, we'll take the thicker lines. Being very careful, if I select a wrong element, to come in and deselect it. N one more line. N. Might just turn down the minimum line length a little bit just to give us some more lines on this side. Before turning it right up again. And N for the last one, right hand side again. So why am I being so picky in taking the right hand side when we're doing the verticals and the top when we're doing the horizontals? Well, that's so I know that these distances are always going to be equidistant. So they're always going to be the same distance between these elements. And that's important for when we come to the calibration. So calibration, I'm going to go one parameter again. The manual does have nice examples of what two parameters and one parameter inverse would look like. So check those out. And once we've selected, it's going to be a one parameter calibration. we can say it's going to be equidistant lines. I don't need to calibrate the center. And the reason for that is that the distortion in our lens is coming from the center. In some lenses, especially older lenses or ones that are, you know, suffering from warping or manufacture of defect, you could find that the calibration center is actually not in the middle of the lens. It's maybe somewhere over here or just off center. But I'm confident that our lens center is actually in the middle. So let's calibrate this. All right. So let's turn my maximum line length up so we can just see what we've got. And I'm going to turn on my grid. Let's take a look at that. That is matching in really, really nicely. We can come up to the top right-hand corner and I can open up viewer preferences here. And it's at this point where I can make my grid even more fine. So let's bring this up to 17 divisions and let's maybe 17 divisions on the Y as well. And you can now see, if I hit close that down, you can now see that our grid is actually fitting in with the distortion that we had on the lens distort there. Let me just copy that. I'm going to show you what happens when we manually try and dial this in. Like if we're lucky, we can manually dial it or get it into the ballpark. But if you're at this stage, shoot yourself a proper calibration thing, because you're causing yourself just, you know, a lot of headaches trying to dial it in. So if I render this out now, render out the undistort, let's have a look. Nice, clean image, completely undistorted grid. And I am happy with that. Okay, let's say we wanted to now apply this data onto a different clip. And before I go, I'm going to just copy this into the clipboard, this number, this K1 number. Just going to copy that into the clipboard and come out here. And let's go to the clip that we actually want to be working on, which is this one here. And I'll go to Mocha Pro, open this up, and we'll come back into Lens. Now, if you want to use an ST map, we can come down and in our distortion, we can go distortion map. And it will tell us, please select both an undistort and distort clips. Okay, so the undistort, let's import that. And we'll find that clip. This is the one, 1116_11. It's a still frame, so it doesn't really matter what else is going on down here. And we'll hit import. I will choose the same one for the inverse. So we can do it like that. This isn't going to work with this clip, which we'll see if I hit render. I'll show you that. The reason it's not going to work, well, a couple of reasons it's not going to work, but the biggest reason it's not going to work is because the size of my undistort map is huge. Remember, that was a 6K file. This is not a 6K clip. This is an HD clip, 1080p clip. Okay, let's come back into the selected layer. So instead of using the distortion map, let's use the one parameter again. And I'll just set these back to none. It's not going to make a difference because we don't have this set to distortion map. Remember, I've still got that K1 value in the clipboard. So if I paste that in, Control or Command V, and let's render that one. Ooh, there we go. So that is more resolution independent. So long as that shot hasn't had any sort of cropping done to it, if it's just scaling up or down, then that distortion is going to work out nicely for us. And let's see that in practice. Let's go to our track. Let's just come to our selected layer. What am I going to track? Let's track down here. There we go. I'll do a unlinked track. And I'll call this one sidewalk track. There we go. And we'll set up our surface. Put that over here somewhere. This is a great time where we just break out the grid so we can see where this one is meant to be going.
probably around about there. Nice thing is, we can always reposition the surface whenever we want. Track perspective, yes please, and let's track that forwards. And we'll track it backwards as well. Excellent stuff. Let's reposition the surface a little bit now. Insert our logo. Turn off everything else. Play that through. And that's nice. That's fitting into place really, really well. Let's see what would happen if we didn't have the lens on. Do the old trick. Just copy that. Set that back down to zero. And we'll remove all of our keyframes again. Come back to our track. And you can see that's it's kind of looks all right because it's sort of lining up, or the movement is pretty consistent. But let's A/B this, shall we? We'll come in, save out this one. This one hasn't got the lens on it. So let's duplicate this clip. Module renders, and we go straight to the insert cutout. And I call this one no calibration. And we'll duplicate this, come back into Mocha Pro, into the lens, put in the proper distortion, which we can see with the grid. So we do have that lens in there properly. And call this one calibrated. Set this to difference mode and let's play that back to see what the difference actually is. And that's actually quite a difference. And just really quickly, just for my own curiosity, I'm going to do the same as before where we put the uncalibrated one over the top at a lower opacity, and we'll just have a little look, see how far out it actually is. There we go. And obviously the further away from the edge, the less it is, but you know, it's fairly significant. So if you're shooting a lot or have shots that are shot with wide angle lenses, or you're seeing, you know, significant sort of pin cushioning or barreling in the lens, then using Mocha to undistort and then redistort is not only a great way to get the right results, but it's really a good way of saving yourself a lot of time, especially if you're doing painting. Painting on wide angle footage is really tricky because if you're doing lots of cloning, you're having to clone in angles, in circles. If you undistort, all of a sudden you're cloning back in straight lines again, and then you can just redistort the paint over the top. In the last three videos, we've gone over quite a bit with the lens module. If you want to get even deeper into it, then I'll always recommend the documentation. Like, there's a lot of time and effort goes into writing the manuals, and it goes into a lot more technical depth than I can cover in these videos here. I'm going to hand you back over to Mary now. And in exercise 19, we're going to start to explore the remove module and just some of the various things that you can do with the remove module that aren't always focused on removing objects. So thanks for now, and I'll see you again soon.
You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at BorisFX.com.